Black holes are a very old idea, from nearly 2.5 centuries ago, and were first postulated in 1783 by Reverend John Mitchell, an English country cleric and scientist. Because of time, distance, and the unreliability of travel, scientific communication often took place by way of letter writing. Mitchell did not make any particular effort to promote his groundbreaking ideas himself. Consequently, his name is frequently overlooked in both scientific history and literature. Mitchell called them dark stars. Russian astronomers called them frozen stars because the immense gravity caused time to stop in their vicinity. The most awkward term was gravitationally total collapsed object, which was so obnoxious that when physicist John Wheeler heard an attendee at a conference call them black holes, he immediately pounced on the name and promoted it heavily. The name stuck. Join us as we take a look at amazing facts about black holes. Black holes are not what you think. Hydrogen, the most plentiful substance in the universe, collapses in the densest spots of the cosmos to start forming a larger mass. When there's enough dense matter, and thus gravity, atomic fusion can take place, and you have a star. Since every atom in the universe has an angle of moment, or turning, and Isaac Newton revealed to us that every molecule is attracted to every other molecule, the gas and other materials circling the star synchronize with the portion having the majority of the motion in the same direction. Eventually, everything ends up traveling in the same direction. This is why disks form centripetally around stars, and why planets orbit in a flat plane around them too. However, when there is too much material in one spot for a star to form, the gravitational force overwhelms the outward expansion force of any fusion pressure. The escape velocity increases until it surpasses the speed of light. From that point on, the matter continues to collapse, and the star vanishes from the visible realm. There is a lightless hole in space. Black holes don't suck. Many people labor under the misapprehension that if the sun were suddenly to become a black hole, that the entire solar system would collapse into it. But nothing could be further from the truth. Practically nothing would change mechanically with the solar system. Yes, with no solar output, Earth would freeze solid, and we couldn't sustain life here. But the gravity would remain exactly the same. The planets would simply orbit the black hole instead. The black hole doesn't reach out, grasping and clawing at all available matter. It is just a gravitational body, like any other, when it comes to effects on other objects. The solar system would remain the same, but a lot darker. Types of black holes. Stellar mass black holes. Scientists believe that there are around 3 to 5 different types of black holes, depending on how finely you wish to categorize them. The best known are the stellar mass black holes, resulting from sufficiently large stars running out of fusion fuel. For smaller stars, such as those slightly bigger than our Sun, they generally collapse into a failed black hole. The gravitational collapse causes protons and electrons to lose their identity to form neutrons instead, resulting in neutron stars. The bigger a star is, the more likely it will continue to collapse, achieving official black hole status. Intermediate black holes. Next is the intermediate black hole, ranging from 100 to 10,000 solar masses. One solar mass is equal to the size of the Sun in our own solar system. It took a very long time to locate any of these. Finally, via the laser interferometer, gravitational wave observatory, we began to figure out how to identify them. So far, they're not as plentiful as we think they should be to fill the gap in the black hole mass spectrum. But at least we now know that they exist, and we're learning how to identify them. Primordial black holes. Primordial black holes are proposed to have been created at the Big Bang. While we ordinarily speak of solar masses to describe black holes, even a few micrograms of material can be a black hole if compressed enough, and those conditions existed near the beginning of the universe. While still hypothetical, many scientists are starting to consider these as a partial explanation for dark matter, since many are too small to detect, and thus a good candidate to explain the missing 70% of matter in the universe that has a gravitational effect, but is invisible. Scientists have also been puzzled by the orbits of small objects beyond Pluto. Something is organizing their orbit, but we don't know what. There is a possibility that we have a pet black hole in our very own solar system, about the diameter of a billiard ball, but with a mass 10 times that of the Earth. Large primordial black holes are also considered as candidates for seeding the origin of our next object, supermassive black holes. Supermassive black holes are only found at the center of galaxies. Most are in the range of 1 million to 10 billion solar masses. Again, a single solar mass is equal to the weight of our Sun. For comparison, our rather large Milky Way galaxy has as many as 400 billion stars, and its supermassive black hole, which is named Sagittarius A star, is about 4 million solar masses, which in our case is 0.001% of galactic mass. That's pretty small compared to others. Quasars. Quasars are not black holes themselves, but they require a supermassive black hole to form. Quasars are the most powerful of what are called active galactic nuclei. Active galactic nuclei are regions at the center of a galaxy that have higher than normal luminosity. And that luminosity is not caused by stars. Instead, the luminosity is from the accretion of matter around a supermassive black hole. In fact, the word quasar is a contraction of the phrase quasi-stellar radio source. Quasars are extremely energetic emitters of X-rays, radio, UV, and visible light, and also the brightest things in the universe. The difference between black holes and quasars is that black holes are cold and dark, while quasars are among the hottest, reaching trillions of degrees, and most luminous entities in our universe, and are actually powered by supermassive black holes. Not every galaxy. While our Milky Way galaxy has one, not every galaxy has a supermassive black hole. There are exceptions, such as the Triangulum Galaxy, which lacks a central supermassive black hole. Black holes are not directly associated with the galactic disk. Instead, they are tied to whether the galaxy possesses a central bulge. In addition, when two galaxies collide, the black hole may be ejected, leaving many of its stars behind, though after such a collision, the galaxy may be more homogeneous with no distinct spiral arms. While Triangulum is a medium-sized galaxy, about one-third of the size of the Milky Way, most with no supermassive black hole are dwarf galaxies. That is not to say a large galaxy never occurs. For example, the supergiant elliptical galaxy, A2261-BCG, has also been found to have no supermassive black hole. Nothing is gone forever. A common idea is, once matter passes the event horizon of a black hole, it is permanently lost to the universe. But that's actually wrong. The event horizon of a black hole is the cutoff point, where at a specific distance from a black hole, the required escape velocity of an object exceeds the speed of light. Since nothing can exceed that speed, including light, scientists theorize that nothing could ever come out of a black hole. Stephen Hawking, the brilliant mathematician, said that since we cannot see inside black holes, they represented an information loss to the universe, which was not possible. Matter and energy, a type of information, can be neither created nor destroyed, as stated by the first law of thermodynamics, aka the conservation of mass, energy. Classical physics says it's lost forever, but Hawking found a leak in all black holes, and that leak was named Hawking radiation. Granted, stellar mass objects will still last for 10 to the 67th power years, and supermassive black holes will last 10 to the 100th power years, many times the age of the universe. These leaks occur in two ways. The first leak. In quantum physics, virtual particles come into and go out of existence constantly. This constant creation and destruction is called the quantum foam. A particle and its antiparticle spontaneously condense energy into matter, come into existence, annihilate with each other, and vanish back into background energy. When this happens at a black hole's event horizon, that energy comes from the black hole itself. In this case, however, one particle goes into the black hole, restoring its portion of the energy. The other particle escapes into the universe, taking black hole energy with it. It's a leak. The second leak. When the universe eventually runs down, which we call entropy, where all remaining energy is converted to heat, the black holes will leak even more furiously. Since Hawking showed that black holes must be a few kelvins above absolute zero, and the universe is hotter than that now, they absorb energy. When the universe cools enough, there will be more energy inside the black hole than outside of it. Energy will flow in the opposite direction. It is even speculated that once enough matter escapes, black holes will have insufficient energy to stay collapsed and will burst open in a violent event. Each supermassive black hole could form millions of new stars and kickstart the universe again. Can you say deja vu? Something to look forward to if you think you'll be around then. Tell us your thoughts about black holes in the comments below, and let us know if you have any suggestions or feedback for us. We appreciate your input. Thanks for watching, and take a moment to check out this next video.